Hi there, everybody. So I thought I would, after all these episodes, give you some feedback. Huh? I bet you thought I was going to read questions and comments and stuff like that that people gave me for feedback. Well, you can see the comments below the videos. And I've managed to answer most of the questions in the series itself. But what I want to address is the quality of the feedback. And, well, you know, whenever you give somebody feedback, like an employee evaluation or something like that, you always have to deal with the question of how much should I varnish this? How much should I make it pleasing versus the unvarnished plain truth? Should I go for impact? Or, you know, should I put it in such a way that you might be inclined to think about it? And the answer is that I don't know. I don't know. I like to hear plain, direct, unvarnished, unfinished feedback, you know, straight from the horse's mouth. Okay, I can deal with that. And it lets me know where I stand. Most people probably aren't like that. Most people probably would prefer for me to soft pedal it and make it nicey nice. So I'm trying to aim for the middle of that spectrum. Okay. In fact, just putting an introduction like this, a little buffer like this, is basically softening the feedback that I would like to give. And the feedback about your feedback is that basically it's almost not there. From this series alone, we've had almost 1,500 views so far. And how many comments? Maybe a dozen. So it means that only 1% of you are giving feedback. So, you know, there's the 1% and then there's the 99%. What are you thinking? Now, I've been told by people that I trust that I'm hard to talk to because I'm intimidating, which really, like, blindsides me. Intimidating? It's like I go out of my way to be friendly and accommodating and giving a balanced, rounded point of view. So for me to hear that I'm intimidating, it's like, you know, why do I even bother trying to be nice? Or why do I even bother trying to meet people halfway, you know? Well, one problem is meeting people halfway is I don't know where you are. I don't have enough feedback to know, to gauge your level of understanding. So I put things in a way that makes sense to me. And the few people who stay in touch with me on a regular basis. But I can't really understand where you are or how you're hearing this unless you tell me, you know? I'm not a mind reader. I'm not interested in mystic powers. Although I certainly can feel the energy. Well, let me explain it to you, like, from my point of view, okay? Let's say you were an inventor. And let's say you developed a technology that makes some essential process, like making paper, let's say. It's just an example. Could be anything. Cars or banking or, you know, whatever. Take some process or some service that people rely on, that people need, and you develop some new technology that suddenly makes it 100 times more efficient, 100 times more cost effective. Now, what is that going to do, huh? That's going to disrupt the industry, isn't it? That's going to shake things up. It's going to make everybody rethink the whole deal. Huh? And of course, it means a better deal for the customers, for the people who are ultimately paying for the product or the process, because it's 100 times cheaper. Wow. So here we have this thing called enlightenment. Okay, now let me explain my view of what enlightenment is so that we're on the same page here, because I know there's 100 different definitions. Enlightenment, to me, first of all, is a natural process. It's just as natural as these birds and trees and grasses out here. It happens. And sometimes it happens to the most unlikely people. Huh? I mean, people that you would never guess, that you would never think. And why is that? Because our human definition of saintliness and purity and sin and whatever inputs go into our judgment of a person's spirituality are completely fabricated. You know, here's these beautiful eucalyptus trees, and they produce these fragrant leaves. Even when they're dry, you crumple them, and eucalyptus, huh? Now, the tree doesn't know that it's doing this. It's not like the tree gets up one morning and says, oh, okay, I'm going to make eucalyptus scent, because it's very, very beautiful. No, the tree just makes it because that's what the tree does. That's what the tree is. So it's not like nature thinks, okay, I need a certain number of enlightened people so that human society doesn't go completely to pot. But enlightened people happen. You know, it's a natural process, okay? There's a nice phrase, many are called, but few are chosen. Well, what does that mean? When we see an enlightened person, we see their grace and their knowledge, and we feel their penetrating energy. Here comes a moth. Beautiful big moth. When we see or feel their compassion, their deep understanding of life, and so on like that, it's very impressive. And some of these people get very famous. And when they do, they get a lot of attention, they get a lot of regard, respect, and worship even. And there's something in us that says, wow, I could do that. I could be like that. Huh? I could say those same things. I could give those same looks, you know? I could be like an imitation of that. I could play that role. You're thinking, yeah, I could do that. And so many are called. Huh? When an enlightened person appears in the world, naturally their fame spreads. Because it's a very unusual, very wonderful thing. So we want to be like that. Huh? How many times have you gone to the cinema, gone to the movies, and then you come out and you feel just like, you know, the hero or the heroine? Huh? You walk a little taller and you think a little more confident. And you have a little more hope that, you know, maybe this life will work out. Isn't it? You identify with that person. And that gives you a certain feeling. So similarly, some people pick as their heroes enlightened people. And they're called to follow. And maybe in the beginning, their motivation isn't so pure, you know. Maybe in the beginning, they're like, oh yeah, wow, wouldn't that be cool, you know. Let me be like that. Oh boy, I bet I'd have a great time. Everybody would serve me. Everybody would take care of me. Oh man, let me be the guru. Let me be the enlightened person. But there's a difference between a teacher and a master. The teacher is certainly called, and the teacher certainly has a lot of knowledge. And a successful teacher will also have knowledge of human nature and how to make things happen, how to engage people, how to direct people. But, you know, a lot of politicians have that too. That's nothing special. In fact, there really isn't anything special about a teacher. A teacher is a knowledgeable person. But enlightenment is not knowledge. Enlightenment is beyond knowledge, even beyond wisdom. So, what is the difference between a teacher and a master? Between a knowledgeable person and an enlightened person? That the enlightened person has been chosen. Chosen for what? To speak as the mouthpiece of the existence, the whole, nature, God, if you want to call it God. That's a very poor term because it's so loaded with all kinds of theological crap. Ideas about God that have been passed down for centuries among unenlightened people. But God simply is the nature, the existence, the whole, the reality. Huh? And somebody has got to speak for that reality in human society. Otherwise, we'll screw ourselves up even more than we already have. There has to be a balance. Human beings, by nature, have a lot of intelligence and power. And if they misuse that power, then the whole nature suffers. Huh? Just like so many species are becoming extinct because of human activity. So climate change is happening. And it's due to human activity one way or the other. Whether it's due to industrial CO2 or chemtrails or satellites or whatever is somehow human driven. If it continues, it's going to make this planet practically uninhabitable. So these are big issues, and the nature needs a voice, needs a spokesperson, a mouthpiece, somebody to communicate in human terms how the nature is feeling about humanity. Okay? And I'm here to tell you that nature is now saying, stop, or I'm going to fucking punch your ass into the next dimension. Stop. Think about what you're doing. Become enlightened, or at least begin the process so that you can understand how you're doing this, why you're doing this, and stop. You know, Uncle Osho, Osho Rajneesh, was talking about artificial intelligence, that you would have access to all the knowledge of the human race on a small computer that fits in your pocket. And he was talking about this in 1978. If you were around back in 1978, How far away were you from that understanding then? But he saw it. He saw it clearly. Right now, when we get out our phone and look up an airplane flight or something like that, we are using artificial intelligence, and it's in our pockets. When we do a Google search, when we get on Facebook, we're using artificial intelligence, and it's in our pocket. 40 years ago, Osho saw that coming. And I'm here to tell you that 30 years ago, or more, I saw this coming. In 2003, I wrote an essay about it called The Ontological Time Bomb. I saw the fragmentation of meaning that allows somebody like Trump to become the president. I saw the fragmentation of society that results in at least one mass shooting a day, in the U.S. At least one cop killing a person of color every day in the U.S. I foresaw those back in, way before 2003, but I finally found the language to write about it in 2003. Back in 2003, were you seeing that that could happen? How far were you? I mean, most people are in the middle of it right now and they don't see it happening because they don't understand meaning. They have no idea of ontology. No idea what drives language, understanding, and ultimately consciousness. So if someone comes up like Osho came up with at least a 10-to-1 cost advantage on the process of enlightenment, and I'm claiming 100-to-1, and that's because of my own experience. I followed Osho's instructions for Secret of the Golden Flower back in 1984, and in like 55 days, I got stream entry. Now, if you don't know what these terms mean, you cannot appreciate the value of attaining stream entry in 55 days of concerted effort. Okay? It's probably more like 1,000-to-1, and I'm being very conservative in claiming 100-to-1. Now, this should cause everybody to go, whoa. But what happens instead is that A, they don't understand what I'm talking about because they don't know the meaning of the terms. And B, they simply don't believe it. Why? There have been so many rascal cheaters come along and claim to be enlightened, and then later on turned out they weren't. And it usually has something to do with sex. Because there's this stupid fixed idea in everybody's mind that if you become enlightened, you don't need sex anymore. And this is bullshit. It's the body's need. The body still needs to breathe, to drink, to eat, to go to the bathroom. The body still needs exercise. It still needs sun. That's what I'm doing out here. I come out here every day to walk and do yoga and swim and get out in the sun, keep myself healthy. So at 69 years old, you know, I still have the energy of a 30-year-old, a 40-year-old. Now, is a body that healthy going to just spontaneously drop sex? Why should it? Why should it drop anything? A body is alive, it's a living animal, and has certain functions, certain needs. Sex is one of those needs, so that's it. So what I'm saying is that those who have given me the most feedback over the last few years have been the anti-sex people, claiming that I'm not enlightened or I'm not a valid teacher or whatever, because I'm still involved with Tantra. It's pathetic. It's a pathetic statement on about you. You see, let's say the position was reversed. Let's say you had discovered some technology that increased the efficiency of your enlightenment process by a factor of 100. And let's say I was the guy watching you on YouTube. What would happen? I would be on there like asking all kinds of questions like, wow, how did you do that? And what happened? And tell me about it. And what about your philosophy? What about this? What about that? I would be all over it. So where are you? You are stuck in an obsolete worldview created by religious people in cahoots with the political people to suppress you, to make you think that you're unworthy of enlightenment. The religious people say, oh, you have to give up sex to be enlightened. And they do a pretty good job of pretending that they've given up sex, which if you have ever lived in a monastery or temple, you would know is a total lie. They don't give up sex. In fact, the first time I went to a Tibetan Buddhist monastery, the Dalai Lama was giving a class. And somehow I got invited. So I was up there for 2 or 3 weeks. And you know, on the third day I was there, a monk approached me and hit on me. A gay monk. And I said, wait a minute. And he did it like openly, flaming in front of a whole bunch of people. And I was like, what? Excuse me? And he was one of the Dalai Lama's hand-picked ambassador, cultural ambassador monks who goes out and does programs at churches and things like that. And I'm like, huh? What? Later on, when I actually became a Buddhist monk myself, I found out the truth. They're not giving up sex. No way. But they pretend to, because then that makes other people lower. See, it runs a guilt trip on everybody. That, oh, you're still doing that? See, it's a smarmy, nasty, elitist kind of dogmatic bullshit that they use to exploit people and suck money and attention out of them. Oh, the great monk, he's given up everything, even sex. No, he hasn't. He's just a little more discreet, a little more careful, a little more private, and a little less honest. So I have this thing about being honest, you know, like keeping your word, telling the truth, stuff like that. I have this funny fetish about that. It's like I can't live with myself if I'm not honest, if I'm not straightforward, if I'm not a plain dealing person. So I don't try to hide anything. In fact, I'm open about it. Yes, when you're doing intense sadhana, and you're really like hot on the trail of realization, you will naturally forget about sex because you're involved in something else. Your interest is elsewhere. When you're involved in a big creative project, or when you're, you know, doing something very intensive, energy intensive, you'll forget all about sex. When you're in the flow, when you're in the wave of energy that comes from a big intention, you'll forget all about sex. Yeah, you will transmute that energy. You'll sublimate it. It'll become transformed into something else. Well, there's all these beautiful moths and butterflies checking out the flowers. See, sex is going on all the time in nature. It just happens. Human beings are unique among all creatures in that they, like, make huge plans about sex. And do all kinds of crazy, unnecessary things to get it and so on. Animals are so straightforward about it, it's just natural. Like, don't sweat it. Don't make a big deal of it. Why make such a big deal of it? That it makes you actually insane. And then when somebody like me comes along, people will reject what I have to offer, even though it means 100% or 1,000% or 10,000% increase in the cost effectiveness of the enlightenment process. Enlightenment is needed by nature. Enlightenment will happen to somebody. It could be you. But you have to make yourself available. You have to make yourself qualified. You have to clean all this human-generated crap from your mind. Make it a fit place for nature, for God, for enlightenment. That's what this is all about. You should be asking all kinds of questions. If I can do this 100 times faster, how? Actually, I've already given. Here you go, little butterfly. I sat on my hand for a minute. How can I make it? How can I do it? I've already given the technique, the basic technique. But of course, you have to apply it to your individual situation. So you would have to ask a million questions. And then there's one thing which I haven't been able to improve on, and that is the necessity for the catalyst of the direct encounter with an enlightened person. I don't think we're going to be able to get rid of that. That's a necessity. There has to be this catalytic relationship between you and someone who is enlightened. So you can feel what it's like. You need at least one example. Living, breathing example, and not just over a video connection, but in person, live. Why? You have to feel the energy. If you can't feel the energy, then, you know, you're sick. I'm sorry. You're ill. You're lost. You're detached from nature, detached from the source. If you can't feel chi flowing in your body, right? And it's a product of sex suppression, again. During our formative years, we're in a social milieu that's completely synthetic. School, And in school, of course, no sex allowed. It's horrible. They turn children into neurotics. It's terrible what they do. It's a crime. And the punishment for that crime is climate change. You have all these neurotics running around, listening to what they're told to do in words, instead of doing what they feel to do by their own energy. Because they're out of touch with their own energy. They have become separated from their own nature. It's horrible. It's horrible for someone who's healthy to have to live in the middle of all that nonsense. It's terrible. So what I'm here to tell you is that if you're going to get this benefit that is available now, this improved technology, and by the way, this improved technology will win in the end because it is better and it does work. And so as soon as I get even a little traction, there's going to be enlightened people popping up all over the place that use this process, and we'll be able to generate them faster than any other process, which means we'll get all the chosen ones in our group. You see? So whether it happens now or after I'm gone, it doesn't matter. Somebody is going to discover these videos. Somebody is going to discover these books and implement them. Maybe somebody who has more leadership ability than I do. And they'll get together a group and they'll make it happen. And it will happen. Just like Osho talking 40 years ago about artificial intelligence, 60 years ago, whatever it was. I can see this coming. I can see a day coming where the human race is under so much survival pressure from climate change that they start finally, desperately seeking the answer. And we have it. Just become enlightened. Just become in tune with nature and you'll do the right thing. You won't be fracking. You won't be building pipelines. That's over. That is so over. That is so 19th century tech. It's like, drop it already. And the same with enlightenment. This business of like Buddhist meditation and all this stuff, this is so like 16th century tech. We've had better since then, and we have much better now. And I think with a little bit more research, we could speed it up by another factor of 10. A little sophisticated biofeedback, huh? When MRI devices become desktop-sized and affordable, then we'll have the tools we need to do that. See? I mean, actually, within a couple of years, it'll be affordable to have a center where you come in and get scan, MRI scan, while being taught meditation so that you get instant feedback. And you'll be able to learn to reverse the flow in like 15 minutes. So, yeah, I'm going on and on and on here. This is getting long. And I already really made my point. But if you were serious, if you were intelligent, if your head wasn't all messed up with all this obsolete bullshit, huh? You'd be on the keyboard asking questions right now. You'd be trying to arrange a visit. You'd be trying to clear the space so that you can have an intensive. Because that's what it takes. And the fact that you're not doing that means you're not serious about life. You're not really playing it for all it's worth. You're letting your doubts steer you away from the biggest opportunity you've ever encountered in your life. And it's hard for me to respect that. I mean, I have to respect it because you're a self-determined being just like I am. You may not know it, and you may not act like it, but you are. So I'm just waiting until you get around to it.